The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. It was evening on the day Jesus rose from the dead, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My dear faithful, today we celebrate the 50 days since the Feast of Easter and bring to an end our Easter celebration tonight at Vespers and then begin our ordinary time next week. And we will have a few celebrations in the following Sundays to reflect on the mystery of God Himself and the mystery of the Eucharist, the Feast of Corpus Domini, Corpus Christi, and also the Feast of Trinity Sunday. These are things following immediately after Easter that allow us to appreciate further certain aspects of the mystery that we celebrate so continuously throughout the year. But today we bring these 50 days to a conclusion, and it's fitting, it's really nice to see that we read the same gospel that we had from Easter Sunday, the events of Easter Sunday night, and we bring to a completion almost to a finality, but also a circular sense of revolving around the mystery that we've celebrated. Seeing it from so many different aspects, touching only a fraction, a tiny, tiny fraction of what the mystery beholds, because it's something hidden in the very heart of God Himself. And today celebrating a final act which can never really end, a final act of the sending of the Holy Spirit through Christ breathing upon them and sending it with the power of the Holy Spirit and the events of that first Pentecost when the flames extending, descended also on the disciples and apostles and reflected that indwelling of the Holy Spirit that the church continues to receive. It's also part of the intercessions and the prayers that we've had over these last 10 days in preparation for this feast day, preparing ourselves, but also asking God, being aware also of our need for the Holy Spirit and its awareness in our lives, our opening to the Spirit that is always there for us. And we've prayed that those gifts be showered upon the church abundantly, as our opening prayer said, as in the early days of the preaching of the gospel after Jesus risen from the dead. So this is the gift that we're given today. It's the one we reflect upon, and we reflect upon going through in the year, but in special way with something that is unseen for us. We see the fruits of the Spirit in the lives of our brothers and sisters and in our own lives as well, but we don't see or have an image of a face of Christ, which is the face of God Himself, in the same way with the Spirit. But that third person who joins in many ways in love the first two persons of the Trinity descends into the world and lives within our hearts recreates the face of the earth and allows us to continue with the very breath that we have in the things that take place in our lives and in the lives of our loved ones. Yesterday, we had the ordination of a young priest for the Archdiocese, Michel Kenville, an elder, unique example of the working of the Holy Spirit in one's life, in their vocation, and then a very special anointing through the hands of the bishop of his calling and also his ordination, his sacred ordination yesterday, to go out for the rest of his life, dedicating himself in the priesthood to Christ and to his people. And that is just one example of the Holy Spirit's work within the church, of many others called to professional vocations, and at this time especially thinking of those taking care of the sick and taking care of all those who are ill in whatever way, a special vocation that God calls in a person's life with an attraction to a person who has already lived that life, exemplary in a fashion that has called others, and in many other vocations as well, those of teaching, in many other aspects of a service to humanity and a service to God, for a creating of a good, common good, shared by others in many ways to dedicate themselves in leisure and all the free time that we're able to have to the religious parts of our lives, which are so, so fundamental. I'm also conscious of the fact that very hopefully, and we continue to pray, that we're reaching an end of this lockdown and an opening of our churches, and I hope it takes place very soon, that we'll be able to have at least 15% or 30%, and sometime in the near future, an open church for all those who are able to come. To express what? To express that commonality of coming together on the first day of the week, which marks everything we do during the year, the feast of joy that we celebrate throughout the entire year. And that is something we'll continue to keep in our prayers as we long for that day, getting back to a normal in which our spiritual lives and our communal religious lives come back to a norm, which is so important for us, and picking up the wounds and the pieces of part of our society that we'll have to do when we get to that stage. This feast day of the sending of the Holy Spirit and our awareness of the Holy Spirit in our lives is something for us to be careful for and to be attentive to, because the Spirit marks our lives in every moment of our lives, and how many times during our day, not just in the calling of our vocations, but in the impulses the Holy Spirit gives to us to be kind, to think of others, to direct our hearts towards God in thanksgiving and in praise and in an act of asking forgiveness, all the aspects of our religious lives, the religious act itself, inspired by the Spirit. And our second reading captures that, even our ability to say, Jesus is Lord, and all the implications of what that means, who Jesus is and what he has done for us, which has marked this Easter season, the impetus and the ability to say that comes from the Spirit himself. And he inspires that within us, almost as a seed to allow us to live this image and this mark of baptism which is within us, to express these religious sentiments which are the core of our lives and of our religious lives as well. We recognize the Holy Spirit, sent by Christ and by the Father, dwelling within us. We pray that it continues to dwell in the church, and especially that the church and all of its members attune their hearts to the presence of the Holy Spirit, listening to the impulses that are there in our lives, striving for virtue, striving for union with Christ, striving for the treasure that lies beyond this world, that lies in heaven for us, that sets the whole order of living in this world, but be not being of this world, and living in a world in which has a temporality, which is always has its treasure in heaven. This is the gift we're given. And we're thankful to the Lord for so many blessings, so many graces that have been given to us in this Easter season, those myself that I've experienced, and I know that so many others have experienced, even in these difficult times, and all the graces that allowed us present during the season of Lent to prepare ourselves to celebrate Easter properly. We bring that to a conclusion, but not a conclusion, a completion, a circle that has been there for us now as we slowly enter into the mystery of the daily life of our church. Celebration of joy, the celebration of joy that lasts every day and that is part of every day of our lives.